This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey everybody, this is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And today I have my friend and a very illustrious member of the internet scene and intellectual production in this world of 2022, Claire Lehmann, who is the editor-in-chief of Quillette. And Claire, do you have an official column in The Australian, or are you just doing a lot more of that?
Yeah, I have a column on Fridays. So if you're in Australia and you buy the Australian newspaper on Fridays, you'll see me in there. I have a dedicated column space.
Awesome. And so I actually like double checked. Obviously, I know you. I have contributed to Quillette and I'm a big fan and everything like that. But I checked your Wikipedia and it now says you are a journalist. Would you define yourself as a journalist?
I suppose so, but I'm not a reporter. So I don't go and report the news, but I do column, trying to synthesize and analyze current and that kind of thing. So yeah, I would consider myself a journalist. For sure.
All right. Okay, that makes sense. So I want to start out asking you about what Americans don't understand about Australia, because over the last couple of years, look, candidly, Claire, people always ask me, like, what's up with you? Why are you in a beef with someone? And I don't actually pay any attention to that because, you know, that stuff comes and goes.
Yeah.
My basic opinion is you express your opinion quite firmly. And sometimes people are a little shocked because they thought you were on their team. And you don't like to play that game, or I don't see you playing that game too well. And they're a little shocked about it. And I'm just like, you know, just if you pay attention, it's how she rolls. So I don't, to me, it doesn't faze me. But, you know, a lot of the issues I think the last couple of years have had to do with Americans talking about Australia as if Australia is just America with kangaroos and a different accent.
Yeah.
And I think you've been clarifying a few things. And I do want to mention Quillette, I think, still does have a predominantly American audience, but mm-hmm. the editorial staff is disproportionately non-U.S. Anglosphere. So there's kind of a disjunction there. It doesn't have to be a disjunction, but it's just an interesting observation. But I think sometimes this surfaces in interesting ways because of differences of perspective that had previously been latent. So could you just elaborate a little bit about that and just talk about like what we don't get about your country?
Okay. Well, I mean, it's a pretty broad question. So I'll try and start, but if you want me to address any specifics, just go ahead and ask. One thing that is different about Australia between Australia and America today is that Australia is not as polarized. We don't have the same level of political polarization. So center-right kind of person, like I'm a classical liberal, but I have friends who are on the left and they're not going to try and, or people who are on the left here in Australia aren't going to try and destroy my business. So a big difference. There's sort of less anger around political issues. So we can take firm stances on political issues without fearing for our livelihoods. We don't fear, you know, people don't worry about getting fired and having their businesses attacked and that kind of thing. So I would just say that the temperature is a lot cooler here in comparison to the United States. Now, bigger cultural differences, I mean, these go back to our founding and history. And I think one of the main differences between the United States and other advanced economies is simply how much liberty is valued compared to something like equality. So if you look at Europe, European countries, Australia, New Zealand, Britain, there's probably more value, more weight placed on the value of equality than liberty. Whereas in the United States, there's more value placed on liberty when compared to equality. And I think the biggest cultural differences that you'll find, the biggest misunderstandings you will find between Australians and Americans, or Americans and Europeans, is between the tension between these two principles. So in other places around the world, equality is held up as a supreme moral virtue. That's not the case in the United States, obviously. So does that help explain some differences?
Yeah. And I think that's like a general stylized, fact that a lot of people could get on board with. And I think this manifested was exposed during I was going to say recent pandemic,
yeah.
But during the current pandemic. And could you just talk about what happened there? Because it was interesting. That's when I got a lot of messages because people know, yeah. I know you. And I'm just like, I am not my sister's keeper. I don't know like what's going on, yeah. here. I have stuff to do. But there was, yeah. a lot of strong emotions there.
Yeah, I can understand. Sorry, I'm just moving around a bit. I can understand that, from an American's point of view, the optics. So for people who aren't aware, I mean, like, I'm imagining everyone's aware, but there was this meme that went viral on the internet about Australia having concentration camps. During COVID. So there was a quarantine facility in the Northern Territory. Now, people went there when they entered the country. They're not going there anymore. They went there during some period last year for 14 days before when they entered into the country. And then there was an outbreak in some Indigenous communities up in the Northern Territory. Now, you have to remember that Australia is a huge country. There aren't hospitals everywhere. We don't have small towns everywhere. If you're out in the desert, if you're out in the outback remotely and you get COVID and you're an Indigenous person, you can die, and whole communities could have died. So the government assisted these people in moving the coronavirus, the COVID positive people, or the people exposed to COVID or whatever, assisted them in moving to these quarantine camps. They were there for a couple of weeks and then they went home. That's what happened. I mean, for Australians, this is not a crime against humanity. It's not it's not a big deal. No one cares. It wasn't an issue in our last election. We just had an election about 2 or 3 weeks ago. Well, it didn't even come up. Whereas for Americans, this was like an egregious violation of human rights. People were falsely imprisoned. It was just like a sacred value had been, it was just sacrilege because, people had their liberty curtailed. Now, for Australians, it just was not really much of an issue. And that's just a difference in moral worldview. Like, that's just a difference in perspective. So I know that Americans find it hard to understand that people around the world find it shocking that little school kids are killed at school through mass shootings. I mean, that's a similar level. I imagine it's a similar level of miscomprehension. Like, we Australians just cannot understand how that can happen in a society, how that is allowed to happen, how there are conditions that give rise to that phenomenon. And I imagine that you guys looking at Australia and seeing that people are put into camps for 2 weeks, you're just like, how the fuck does that even happen? Like, you just can't comprehend it. It's a similar level of miscomprehension. We just can't, it's a different cultural, it's like different religion. We don't understand it.
Well, I mean, do you think Americans have, do you think it's harder for Americans to understand Australians and vice versa? Because I feel like, you guys are not that populous of a country. In terms of your economy and your culture, you must be more integrated, interdependent on the rest of the world than we are. I mean, do you think a lot of it?
Yeah. So that's a good point. We're aware that we're not the center of the universe. So we are aware that there are peculiarities about our culture that don't exist in other countries. So the thing that bugs me sometimes about Americans is this: Americans can sometimes not understand that what is valuable to them is part of American culture, and it's not valuable to everybody else. So that I think because America is the richest and most powerful country in the world, there can sometimes be a lack of awareness that there are other cultures that have other cultural values, and that American culture doesn't extend to the entire world and the entire universe.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, obviously it can't by definition. I mean, we are the center of the universe. For there to be a center, there has to be a periphery, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, when it comes to Americans and Australia, you know, there are some stupid misconceptions we have. For example, I have talked to multiple Americans who assume that Australians will periodically see kangaroos running around in their front yard like we see deer, you know, which I don't think that is correct. But what do you think is the biggest misconception that Americans have about Australia? Do you think it's just that they think Australia is just like America? It's just on the other side of the world? Or is there something more substantive besides liberty and equality? Like, I mean, what is like life like in Australia, you know, in a way that is qualitatively different from what we would feel and see in the United States?
Well, life is probably not that much different, but we do have, so we would be, a lot of Americans, if they lived here, would think that we are a socialist country. We have universal healthcare, socialized healthcare. We have, like, the state that I live in, New South Wales, is going to spend something like $100 billion on infrastructure over the next 4 years. We pay high taxes, and those taxes go into public services. So you can be fairly poor in Australia. You cannot have a job and live a pretty comfortable life. You will get welfare benefits. You'll get to go to the doctor for free. If you want, you can go to university for free. Public schooling is quite good. So we just have a lot of public infrastructure that is paid through taxes. We're a very wealthy country because we have iron ore and coal that we sell to China. And we're just lucky in the sense that there's a lot of money here. It gets spent on the people through public infrastructure. And there's a lot less anger here because there's a lot less people live comfortably. There's a lot less economic hardship. If you look at our Gini coefficient, I think it's one of the best in the world in terms of advanced economies. There's a small gap between the richest people. I think the gap between the mean wealth and median wealth is quite small. So we don't have the spread that you guys do in the United States, where you've got all of these billionaires and then you've got all of these homeless people and people living in poverty. We don't have that extreme inequality. And so because we don't have that extreme inequality, people are just a little bit more relaxed. They're a little bit more trusting. It's a very easygoing culture. And we just don't sort of see the anger and the tension that you guys sort of exhibit in your part of the world.
Yeah. Well, I mean, maybe not Canadians, but Americans. Yeah, I think that's fair. There's some anger and some tension. I was actually at a conference this weekend, and there was an offhand comment that people were making that Canadians tend to be, they tend to have high cost of living for various reasons, and their salaries are not that high. But they were saying that in Australia, people just tend to have a lot more money. And so, you know, people will run into Australians who work service sector jobs. You know, I don't want to say lowly, but, you know, like not necessarily what we would not consider high paying service sector jobs. And they're on vacation abroad. And that's just really strange for an American, because people like that do not. I mean, only like 40% of Americans have a passport anyway. I mean, we're a big country. We have a lot of stuff internally. So I don't want to exaggerate, but the impression that these conferences, and these are mostly techies, were just saying that, you know, how is it that, you know, lower socioeconomic status, you know, job holders in Australia can travel the world? Like, how does that work? And I think some of it is what you're talking about, the redistribution, as well as the economy. And let me want, this is not part of the notes, so I'm just kind of like springing this on you. You know, we in the United States have been having issues the last couple of years with China, actually since the end of the Trump administration, and kind of a move away from the Chimerica, the integration. And I don't want to exaggerate, you know, Walmart, Apple, all these countries are still deeply, you know, connected with China. The NBA is still kissing China's butt, you know, that sort of thing. But you in Australia, you have a really intense connection with the China, with the export oriented economy of natural resources. And some of your, the fact that I don't know if you guys have really had a true recession in like two generations or something. I mean, I know that COVID was a little different, but that doesn't really count. And a lot of it has to do with the rise of China, right? Like rising tide lifts all boats. You were a boat, you got lifted. And then China started kind of being a bully recently. And so how does that feel like in Australia right now?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because that's the most important question politically for us at the moment, is how do we manage our relationship with China going forward? And you're right, we're wealthy because of China, because we sell them iron ore that they turn into steel and coal, which powers their has powered their industrialization. And I think it's something about 30% of our exports go to China. So they're our biggest trading partner. And when they do decide to bully us, so like in the last couple of years, they've decided to put a boycott on our wine, and they boycotted our lobster, and it destroyed, like just before Christmas or something like that. And there were shipping containers full of lobster just sitting in transit, because China decided to put boycotts on lobster and wine, and it destroys entire industries. And so we're quite vulnerable to sort of economic terrorism, you could say. And it means that we can't, so we've tried to criticize China. So our former Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, wanted an investigation into where COVID came from, and there was some economic retaliation for that. So we're in a corner where we can't criticize China too much, otherwise our economy is hurt deliberately and strategically. But at the same time, you know, we've got a very proud liberal culture, and we don't, you know, most Australians do not want to be coerced and bullied into submission. So, yeah, it's a difficult relationship. We've just had a change of government, and the new government has come in and had our diplomat or our ambassador, I don't know, they reopened diplomatic relations with China. So there was a diplomatic freeze. The Australian Minister for Trade was not able to get onto the phone with his Chinese counterpart, but that's changed because we've had a change in government. So hopefully things will be smoothed over, but it's a complicated relationship. I don't envy anyone in government, because I wouldn't know what to do about this situation, because it's very difficult.
Okay. Well, I mean, that's what I was fearing, but you know, it is the world as it is. Can you talk about, so you wrote a column about universal voting, and I knew about this. So basically, it's against the law, I think, if you can vote in Australia legally, to not vote. And, you know, I knew about this. This was one of those weird things you learn about in a government class in America, actually, sometimes, like, you know. But it's one of those weird things, like the existence of the platypus. Yes, it's technically true, but it's just really bizarre from an American perspective, okay? Yeah. So talk about that and what the implications of that are for your political culture.
Yeah, no, I compulsory voting is fascinating. And I think we're the only country in the world that actually enforces it. So there's a handful of countries around the world that have compulsory voting, but they don't enforce it. It's not like you get a severe punishment if you don't go and vote. I forgot to vote in a council election and I have a fine sitting on my desk and it's for $20. And I think if you don't pay it, like, they're not going to come after you because it's $20. But it does have pretty big ramifications for the political culture. So what happens is, because voting is compulsory, it's extremely easy to vote in Australia. So if you, on election day, you wake up, you have breakfast. It's, election day is always on a Saturday, for one. You wake up anywhere you live, like the local school will be a voting polling station. You'll maybe line up for 5 minutes. Mandatory voting means that the government is required by law to provide voting materials to every single citizen in the country. So if there are citizens living in a remote part of Australia, the Australian Electoral Commission has to get to them. So there were choppers flying out into remote parts of Australia with the voting materials. So people living out in the middle of nowhere were able to vote. And the Australian Electoral Commission sent people out on boats to get to people on islands. And so everyone votes, and then the election results are counted on the night of the election day. So in our last election that happened about three weeks ago, I think it was, we went and voted, put on the TV at night, the counting starts, and then it's all over by 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. There's always a few, you know, they have to count postal votes, but they know what the overall result's going to be. And our Prime Minister, our previous Prime Minister, conceded on the night, and we had a new Prime Minister by morning. And it was like the day after that, he was on a plane and went and met Joe Biden. So it's done very quickly and efficiently. And what happened, I think one of the most important things that happens because of compulsory voting is that everyone accepts the result. Everyone just recognizes that this is the majority position. This is what people want. So we accept it. And then we get on with dealing with what the election means, as in, okay, so in our last election, a lot of votes were decided, were motivated by disgruntlement with climate, inaction on climate change. So the biggest issue for many Australians at the last election was climate change. So that it just comes out very clearly that that's what the majority wants. They want something to be done about climate change. So you recognize that's the majority position and then you just get on with it. I think when you've got systems where a lot of people don't show up to vote, it's harder to accept that there's a majoritarian position. You know, I think you guys had that with the 2016 election when more people voted for Hillary Clinton, but then Trump won because he won the electoral vote. And it just, people were not willing to accept the result because the popular vote was discordant with the electoral college vote. Lots of people didn't rock up to vote in the first place. So there's less acceptance that that's what everybody wants or what the majority of the population wants. And there are other ramifications as well. Because there is compulsory voting, politicians don't have to campaign as much, and they also don't have to appeal to their base. So they appeal to the swing voter, which forces them to be centrist. So if you're just trying to rev up your base to get out to vote, you're going to emphasize more fringe, more extreme, more sort of fanatical positions. Whereas if you're appealing to the swing voter, you're going to be sort of by definition more moderate. And that's another contributing factor to our sort of low temperature, our cool temperature on political issues. It's because our political system is sort of designed to facilitate moderate centrist politics.
Well, so, you know, in the United States, actually in Britain to some extent, in a lot of Western countries, the left of center parties, you know, whether the Democrats or the Labour, I mean, I guess the Liberal Party in Canada, which is totally different than the Liberal Party you guys got in Australia, but that's a different thing, you know, have been captured by professional managerial class liberals, kind of like, you know, his gentry class, you know, United States, mostly white Democrats, white liberals, and they've been imposing their cultural, I mean, I'm going to say imposing because that's just true, their cultural values on the broader society and on their broader coalition. Is that not happening in Australia then?
Well, it is. It's starting to happen. But there's been, so there's less concentration of power. So if you take the United States, you know, a lot of your economy comes from, like, take California. A lot of the economy comes from urban areas, Hollywood, and obviously Silicon Valley. So, you know, a lot of the innovation comes from the from white collar professionals. Whereas in Australia, our wealth comes from the ground. It comes from mines. So people go out to the mines and they dig up minerals from the ground. And that's, you know, miners are extremely rich in Australia, and our billionaires are billionaires because of they own mines. Now, obviously, we have a finance sector in Sydney. Like, I live in Sydney and it's a rich city. There's huge finance industry. There's a startup industry. There's software development here, but it's not comparable to somewhere like Silicon Valley. So, I mean, most educated, smart people in Australia are aware of where our money comes from. Like, every Australian who has stock, who has investment in shares, knows that the our wealth comes from the mining companies. And so there's less of a divide between urban and rural, because it's not a case that we've got these industries that are completely, you know, we don't have an equivalent of Hollywood here. We don't have an equivalent of, I'm just trying to think of another industry that's completely located in a city that is
like fashion in New York.
Yeah, I mean,
culture in general.
Yeah, we don't have that here. I mean, if you took away the exports of minerals, beef and wine, and maybe wool, our economy is just self-serving. So we're not exporting ideas to the world. We're not exporting culture to the world. So I think there's more of an understanding and more of a reliance on the rural regions. And so there's less antagonism. I think in the United States, and I don't know what it's like in Britain, that, you know, you can just ignore the farmers, you can ignore the people living in the regions, and nothing happens to your economy. And you know, you guys, like in Australia, all of the manufacturing jobs have been outsourced to China. So less dependent on the regions for economic productivity. Well, that process has happened in Australia as well, but not to the same degree, I would think. And so, yes, we do have a gentry class, and they are imposing their values on the rest of us to some degree, but I don't think I don't think it's as extreme as in other places for the reasons that I mentioned.
Well, I mean, I do have to take objection to this idea that Australia doesn't have cultural exports. Have you seen the Crocodile Dundee films?
Yeah, but that's made before I was born, man. But we don't. Anyone that's good in our film industry goes to Hollywood. So you guys suck up all the talent.
Yeah, well, like Mel Gibson, although he was originally an American.
Yeah. I don't know what happened to him.
Wait, what do you mean you don't know what happened to him?
No, I don't know. Is he still making movies?
Yeah, he's back. He's been uncancelled. What I've heard about Mel Gibson is, you know, all the things they say about him are true. He's a drunk, he's an anti-Semite, he's a racist. But he also has a lot of friends in Hollywood because despite his obvious anger management and alcohol issues, he's actually like pretty kind and competent to work with. So he's been like, I mean, for example, he and Jodie Foster are really close.
Okay.
And Jodie Foster's a lesbian, very liberal, but she's basically apparently been his number one backer whenever he has gotten in trouble, which has been pretty regular over the last 20 years. And he just keeps coming back, and you know, he's leaning on his like social capital that he's accumulated based on that. You know, I mean, people are strange. Like, you would never know. I've heard, for example, that, you know, I'm just going to say it, Sean Hannity's kind of like a dumb demagogue, you know, on Fox News. But he's apparently also the type of guy who's extremely kind to the help on the set and the janitors in the building. And he talks to people and stuff like that. So some of these people, you wonder why they're still around, how they got where they got, despite a lack of intelligence or an uncouthness. And it's because you don't see the personal side of them, where they can accrue some, like, in, you know, real life capital, which in some of these industries, that's you know, a thing. So, I mean, speaking of industries and capital and all that, so you are the editor in chief of Quillette, which is kind of a big deal, online. And I think most people know the general, you know, genesis, you know, 5 years ago, you know, you kind of came into the space of like heterodox writing, thinking, publication. And, you know, if there's any one person, I mean, you were there before Quillette as Claire Lehmann. Like, Quillette didn't create you. You created Quillette. So, I mean, I know some of the editors. I know there are people who've been associated with it for a long time. But, you know, there have been people also who've come and gone, and you're always there. So, I mean, it must be a little strange to be so tightly associated with this publication. I mean, does that feel weird sometimes?
Well... maybe. I don't know how else it would feel, though. It's definitely my creation. And so it's like my middle child. I've got two kids and I created Quillette in between them. So it's like a middle child.
And so I was just curious about what people are saying online, and people say a variety of things. One thing is for my Google, like, autocompletes, it actually says the Quillette tribe, like it's trying to correct the spelling. Native American tribe. And then there's like other things like editor, pronunciation, podcast, magazine. And then it says Joshua Katz. So I have to ask you, is Joshua coming on staff?
Oh, no. I think he's been hired by the new Criterion.
Okay, yeah, and I think he might have some other stuff going on. And just you know, like, you know, you don't need to like recapitulate the whole thing, but can you just, for the listener, make it clear like what happened to Joshua Katz and the role that Quillette might have played in that?
Yeah. Okay. So, I don't know Joshua, so I'm just going to paint the picture in very broad brush strokes. He was a classics professor at Princeton, Princeton had some kind of, you know, it was post George Floyd, and some academics put out a very ridiculous statement listing all sorts of demands, and there were specific demands for academics of color to receive some kind of special treatment. Now, Joshua Katz objected to these demands and wrote a piece for Quillette about it. And the piece did very well, but it got him into a lot of trouble. He had been, prior to writing this piece for us, he had, 15 years ago, he'd had some kind of relationship with a student. It was investigated and, it was determined that he, you know, there was some kind of violation of policies. You know, there was nothing, absolutely nothing criminal or nothing to do with sexual harassment. It was just that you're not supposed, you know, when you're a professor, you're not supposed to have a relationship with a student. So he was investigated for that. And the result of that investigation was that he was placed on unpaid leave for a year. He served his time, came back to work. Now, he wrote the piece for us. Students at Princeton were not happy and they went digging into his past. And apparently they discovered that there was this prior transgression, and they somehow got the administration to reopen the investigation, relitigate the investigation. Some new evidence came to light. Again, nothing that normal people would consider egregious or even harmful. Just, you know, it's just one of these things where you're not supposed to do it in a university setting, and he's been fired. And unfortunately, we played, we didn't knowingly play a role in this. It's just that he was punished basically for publishing in our pages, and the behavior and actions of Princeton's president and administration appear very vindictive and just atrocious for a university.
And just to put this in context, I'm looking at the publication date. It is July 8th of 2020.
Yeah.
This was a month after the beginning of the George Floyd protests, and candidly, I think there was an atmosphere of hysteria on university campuses. The American cultural left was on the march. You know, I will say right now that I have had friends who were pressured into signing various things, and they were told if they didn't sign, and these are graduate students, people would notice that they didn't sign. And so their professors were saying, you should sign, figure out a way to sign, because you don't want to be stuck out there, you know, and all of this stuff. I mean, it was a crazy time. I did see Katz's piece in Quillette at the time. I pretty much agree with it, whatever. But I also thought, candidly, he was crazy. And he must have, I mean, I'm assumed that he had a lot of tenure and a lot of friends and a lot of protection.
That's the thing. He was tenured.
He was tenured, and he did have a lot of friends, and then he didn't.
Yeah.
So there were some assumptions that he had made. And, you know, the thing with tenure is, like, if they dig deep enough, they can probably, you know, get rid of tenure from a lot of people. You know, there are a lot of infractions here and there. Grants get waylaid or I don't know. But, I mean, it's one of those things. If they go digging, they can get a lot of people. You know, a friend of mine who's, you know, he's like a little bit on the center right. He's in academia, and he's basically telling me, you know, he just advises anyone who has heterodox views to the left of, like, maybe Bernie Sanders, or to the right of Bernie Sanders, to just, like, be above reproach, because they'll come for you. So, you know, I don't want to say, like, I told you so, but as I read that, I got a really bad feeling.
Right.
Because, and I know some, I mean, not personally, but I knew some of the people who signed that Princeton thing, for example. It was everybody. Yeah. It was crazy, the unanimity and the lockstep. So he was basically staring down a wall, a human wall. And institutions, rules, norms, none of that's going to protect you when there's a will.
Well, you've been a critic of illiberalism on campuses for years, and I've seen you say things like, there's not, like, to me, you're one of the most pessimistic people when it comes to this issue. Like, other people will say, oh, you know, we need to fight back, you know, people need to speak up, things like tenure must be used in order to protect freedom of speech, that kind of thing. But you're, like, I've seen you for years say there's not really any point.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult. The issue is there's cohort turnover. Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I have friends, I'm thinking of one guy, he'll probably be in the National Academy of Science. He's Generation X professor. And, you know, he's pretty liberal, probably Elizabeth Warren liberal. Okay. Put it that way.
Yeah.
And he's telling me the graduate students are communists. They're crazy. So it's like, you know, and they're the ones, for example, when I get attacked, it's usually pressure from the communist graduate students. So these people are going to get tenure. These people are going to the assistant professor pipeline. So, I mean, fundamentally, unless you shut down the universities, you're going to have to deal with a bunch of extremely radically left people who terrify, you know, like, I had an ex-friend, like, I would call him an ex-friend now, but he was, you know, he was being mau-mau'd by the graduate students about his associations with me. And he just was straight up on Twitter, like, let's listen. I want to hear what the young people have to say. And I'm like, it's over then.
Yeah.
If you're listening to what the young, because you are the mentor, that's what they're supposed to be. They're the professors. They're the mentors. So when they're flipping it around like that, that means they're scared. And that means the cultural winds are with the activists. Now, this doesn't mean that the whole culture is going to be like that, because now there's sort of like a selection bias where I know many people who are moderately liberal to the, and further right, who are exiting out of academia. They get their PhD, they go into industry, they do other things. It's affecting the professional managerial class in general, but it's extremely concentrated in academia because of these positive feedback loops. Where, why would you want to be, you know, in an environment where you're being forced to sign on to things you don't even agree with?
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And you're being constantly scrutinized, and, you know, you basically have to convert, which some people have, like, it's like a religious conversion. Like, all of a sudden, all the things that they had previously said don't hold, and now they believe all these things, and, you know. And so, I mean, my pessimism just comes from, you know, I've always been a loudmouth and said controversial things. And, you know, I had a lot of friends in academia 10 years ago. And now they're kind of falling away. And I haven't changed at all. I mean, I'm probably actually way more low-key than I used to be. But that doesn't matter. They're getting more and more radical. And sometimes they privately just tell me they can't be seen to be friends with me. It's like middle school. And that's fine. I'm not complaining. But to be entirely candid, there's a lot of lying, subterfuge, and politics going on in academia. And so if the whole point is to establish the truth and give people sinecures, that's not what's happening. So people just need to wake up and understand what this is. And it is not, you know, John von Neumann and Richard Feynman and Freeman Dyson and whatever. This is not. We're not talking like Rosalind Franklin getting cancer because of X-ray crystallographer. These people are activists. A lot of them are activists. And they want to change the culture. And so that's why I'm pessimistic. But, you know, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm just too close to it. So, you know, we've been talking for a while, so I want to move on, and I want to ask you about – I don't want to get too much into it. It's a little gossipy, but you get into Twitter spats all the time, okay? And I kind of alluded to this. And I don't personally care because I mean, you know my personality. Like, I will talk back to people if they annoy me. So I'm not one to ever criticize someone for being a little salty, right? Yeah. But like, I think the reason people ask about your Twitter spats is you have a huge following. You're the editor in chief of Quillette, and I think they maybe expect a little bit more gravitas from you, forgetting that it's not like you're 60, first of all. But what do you think about like what I'm saying here? I mean, like, what's going on with this? I mean, are you comfortable with – and like some of the people that you get into spats with, I don't follow all the details, but it seems like there's been a parting of the ways. And like sometimes people will be like, how can you be friends with so-and-so and so-and-so? And I'm like, I didn't even know that there was some beef. I don't know what you're talking about, you know?
Well, I would say that I'm probably shouldn't be getting into Twitter spats. I mean, it's a juvenile, immature, impulsive thing to do. And so that's just a reflection of my poor impulse control, really. And I'm learning and I'm getting better. And really, I've been taking breaks from Twitter because I actually just find Twitter to be very toxic. And it's not – I used to get a lot of positivity out of it. Like, I used to enjoy it. It used to be great for business. I used to find writers, and I found like supporters of Quillette through Twitter. But things have changed, and I think things shifted during COVID, and a big gap, a big divide, sort of widened between my American audience on Twitter and my editorial position on things like vaccines. And it's just, I'm not going on certain topics. I'm just sort of, I'm happy. Like, basically, Razib, I don't think the customer is always right. And so if I've got readers or people making complaints about my editorial position on certain issues, particularly things like vaccines, like I don't have the patience or the fortitude or the grace to deal with it in a polite manner.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
you know, I didn't create Quillette to be a, I created it for, so it could be a place where I could feel comfortable being myself and be authentic, and for other people to come and be authentic. And it's not, we've never really been into public relations and PR. And you know how you said that in the university world, there's a lot of lying. Well, we don't lie. And that means, you know, and that can sometimes lead to arguments, but we're not like, I always just say, like, I say what I think, and that can rub people up the wrong way sometimes. But it's either I stay off social media, I stay off Twitter and I don't get into arguments, or I'm on it and then I get into arguments with people.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the last thing I'm going to ask about this, because I want to ask about the IDW bit and we can close out. So I also have sharp elbows. I don't get into like spats as much because I will often just ignore people, but I come at people sometimes and they're a little taken aback because they're like, oh, I thought you were friends. And I'm just like, yeah, but you're being stupid, so I'm just going to come at you. You know, I don't know. I don't have much patience. So I get you. Do you think some of this might be a little bit having to do with your age and sex in terms of people do not expect a youngish woman to behave like that? I wonder, because like I don't think I'm that different online than you, but I don't get into as many spats. I don't have as many followers, but it's not like an order of magnitude.
You know, I don't know the answer to that question. I think one thing that happens, and doesn't just happen to me, it happens to other people with large followings, is that you get a bit spiky because you get a lot of low-grade abuse like every day. So, like, I see it happening to Jordan Peterson a little bit. Like, he gets spiky because he's getting trolled and abused all the time. And so I get a lot of abuse. And so when people, like, I'm faster to get into heated disagreements because I'm sort of defensive because of all of the abuse. And I don't know if that's because I'm a woman. Probably isn't. I think it's just an artifact of having a lot of followers. But that's what I mean about Twitter being toxic. Once you get to a certain level of followers, you just get trolled and abused by haters.
Yeah.
And it's just toxic because then, you know, you can't enter into sort of conversations and mild disagreements with people without just like telling them to go fuck themselves, which, you know, I do too often. And that's because... And I think that's just because your general mood is low because of the amount of abuse that you're getting in general.
Yeah. Well, okay, so the last thing I'm going to say about Twitter, and it's a positive thing, and I know that they are going to be listening, but there are two people that I know in Austin who are engaged, and they met on a comment thread between me and you on Twitter. So, and actually, like, you know, the guy moved from Canada to the United States. So it's kind of like one of those love stories. And so there are positive things that happen out of Twitter. Just want to tell people, not usually that, but that's literally what they told me. And I have Chinese food with these guys all the time. So they're friends and I know that they listen. So I just want to give them a call out. Okay. So last thing I want to ask, intellectual dark web, this was a whole thing. I don't know. Was it like 4 years ago now? Something like that. Barry Rice wrote an article in New York Times Magazine, and you were in that article along with people like Christina Hoff Sommers and the Weinsteins. And it's Weinstein, I think, right? Anyway, it's just like the right pronunciation. But in any case, and then, you know, I like most of the people in the IDW. Some of them I know, some of them I don't know. So I have nothing negative to say about this whole branding, whatever it was. And Quillette, I think in some ways, I mean, I don't know, maybe you might disagree, it was almost became an IDW kind of like house, you know, publication for a lot of these thinkers. I mean, some of them were big ahead of time, like Sam Harris kind of, and he didn't, you know, he's probably a reader, not a writer, you know, but for Quillette, you know, it became kind of at the center of that. And now I feel like the IDW, from what I've heard and what people say, is kind of like dissolved. And I was talking to, I was talking to Iona Italia of Ario, and I was asking her to describe her magazine in relation to Quillette. And she didn't actually think Quillette was IDW anymore. She wasn't very clear what it was, but I think she just kind of said IDW is not a thing, so it can't be by definition. Like, what do you think about that?
Well, I think the term IDW, I mean, it's not my term. It was Eric Weinstein's term. And I think it identified something that was real, and that was that 4 or 5 years ago, whatever it was, you know, it was really difficult to find unorthodox perspectives on a lot of issues to do with identity politics, so anything to do with gender, race, was sort of like anything in mainstream, you know, anything in the New York Times was very, very predictable. And, you know, Quillette really, we made a name for ourselves for pushing back against a lot of those orthodoxies around identity politics. But our disagreement with the establishment kind of stops at identity politics. So, like, I don't disagree with the establishment when it comes to health, public health. I don't disagree with the establishment when it comes to national security. And so the IDW kind of made a bit more sense when anti-establishment thinking was restricted to identity politics. Since that time, obviously, we've had the pandemic, and some members of the IDW, such as Brett Weinstein, were anti-establishment on public health, and we were not anti-establishment, so we don't overlap with him at all on those issues politically. And so I guess we have a lot less in common than we did prior to the pandemic because of that. And now, like, since the Ukraine war has begun, it's another issue where I'm not anti-establishment on that topic, and, you know, neither are the other Quillette editors. So just because we're anti-establishment in one domain doesn't mean we're going to be anti-establishment in every single domain. Whereas I think some thinkers in that clustering perhaps are just contrarian on everything, and we're not like that. So, I mean, I would just say that that's roughly why the group doesn't really make sense anymore.
Yeah, and I do want to say about Quillette, you know, we've been talking about, I don't know, I brought up Joshua Katz and the IDW and all this stuff. But there's a lot of material that you guys publish that's not in any way related to the culture war. You know, I don't know. I mean, I don't think Joel Kotkin's work on urbanism is necessarily culture war. I'm seeing, like, that's something that's on your front page right now, reconsidering the city. And, you know, I mean, periodically, like, I'll do a book review and, you know, usually we've got science or something like that. So, or like you have a piece on Southeast Asia by Imran Saeed. You know, Quillette is much broader than I think a lot of people think, based on maybe the stuff that goes viral in culture war threads on Twitter, candidly, right? I think that's conscious on your part, probably.
Yeah, I mean, we've been doing this for a long time now, and we find a lot of culture war topics to be boring. I mean, there's only so many articles you can publish on why racial segregation is wrong and racial essentialism is a bad idea, and why, you know, the patriarchy isn't really a predictive concept, you know, it's not a very good way of explaining the world. And, you know, there's only so many articles that you can run on these issues, but we're still curious people and we want to read interesting, thoughtful analyses on lots of different topics. So we do publish on a broad range of subjects.
Yeah, that's for sure. So I guess let me ask you one last question then about Quillette. You've been doing this for 5 years. Now, I think 5-10 years from now, are you anticipating that you're going to be editor in chief of Quillette? And, you know, where do you think you might be headed right now in terms of the culture war aspect? I will say that I see a lot of like gender sex related stuff is the primary thing. But I don't know if 10 years from now, that's going to be the same. I mean, what is your like broader ultimate vision? I think we've talked a little bit about this on offline, but, you know, I would like you to say it on the podcast.
Mm. Well, I want Quillette to be an institution that lasts a long time. So I do, you know, and me being the owner and publisher, I might not be editing, you know, I might not be running the business as I am today, but I do want to be the publisher and owner because my motivation is not primarily financial or commercial. It's because I think an institution that publishes challenging material is important, and I think having spaces, intellectual spaces like Quillette, is just important in general. So I want to preserve it for that reason, and I have, you know, like I can do other work alongside Quillette. That means I'm not financially dependent on the company. I just want it to last as an institution. I want talented, thoughtful people to have it as a platform where they can publish and potentially work as editors. And I want it to be an institution where talent is cultivated and I suppose my political values are also very important to the project. So I'm politically moderate, and I, as you know, particularly as culture wars become very inflammatory and people get very divided and start hating each other, I want it to be a space where people can come and the temperature is cooler and people can think through issues in a more deliberative, thoughtful fashion rather than just in this tribalized, polemical fashion that is so popular in a lot of other media institutions. And one of my favorite things about the project is just that very talented people can come through and use it as a stepping stone to bigger and larger things. Like someone like Coleman Hughes can come and write for us, and now he's gone on to his own thing. And, you know, I love that about Quillette, that we can, you know, new upcoming talent can come and work with us and then go on to bigger and better things. And that's like my favorite theme about the work. So yeah, I mean, it's a labor of love, not just for me, but for people like John Kay and Jamie Pump as well. Like we're all motivated for reasons that are not commercially, not dependent on commerce. So, you know, it's a very enjoyable job, and we'll keep doing it for as long as possible.
I think it's been a great conversation, and I hope the listeners have learned a lot. Check out Quillette. I mean, I'm sure most of you know Quillette, but, you know, if you think it's just culture war, that is not, you know, everything. And I guess we'll see a little bit of you, a little less of you on Twitter, Claire, but, you know, hopefully the quality of the signal will go up as you get less annoyed by all the trolls because you're not on there all the time, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's probably a good idea. Good chatting with you, Razib.
All right. Take care, Claire.
Yeah. Cheers. Okay.
This podcast for kids. Yeah.